Thank you so much for inviting me back. I love to come here and see all the familiar faces from the old days. Those of you who brought your Bibles this morning, may wish to open them to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 15, verse 11, and follow along, though there is some difference between her translation and mine. Once upon a time, there was a rich rancher who had two sons. The younger son, Billy Lee, became restless with life on the ranch and wanted to see the world. So he went to his dad and asked for his share of what he would inherit someday. And his father agreed and divided the estate, giving half to Billy Lee and half to the older son, Tommy Bob. And they each received part of the land and cattle. A few days later, the younger son turned the whole of his share into cash and left home for a distant country. And there he lived it up for as long as that money lasted. I mean, he had a good time. Wine, women, song, parties, and friends, new friends who were just more than pleased to help him spend his money. And eventually, of course, it was gone. And Billy Lee began to feel the pinch. Now, about that time, a recession hit that country, and there were hard times for everyone. Jobs were few and far between, but Billy Lee did find a job. He talked to a man who owned some land out in the country and asked Billy to go out there and take care of the pigs on the farm. Now he was alone. No one gave him anything. And there were long, hard days. And eventually he felt he was in extreme poverty and despair. There were days when that boy was so hungry, he would have been glad to eat what the pigs would eat. He thought about wiring home for money, but he was too ashamed. Meanwhile, back at the ranch, his dad had heard all about this reckless living and feared that his son was in serious trouble, perhaps even dead. And so every afternoon he would sit out on the front porch of the ranch house and gazing his off into the distance, watching that road and hoping against hope that he would see his son coming back. Months passed, and one morning Billy Lee woke up with a belly-aching hunger. And his hunger was greater than his shame. "This is ridiculous," he said. "Back home, my father's hired hands have more food than they can eat, and here I am starving to death. I will go back to my father and beg him to forgive me. I will say, 'Father, I've sinned against you, against God. I've wasted my inheritance, and I'm no longer fit to be your son. I don't ask for that. But let me live here again. Treat me like a hired hand.'" He had resolved to make his apology and hope for the best. So Billy Lee set out for that long journey to home. And after many miles of walking and hitchhiking, with little food or shelter along the way, he was a sad sight. Dirty, thin, haggard, ragged. As he got close to home, he grew more and more fearful. He was still a long way off when his dad came outside and looked down that road and saw the boy and recognized him. The father walked down across the lawn to get a closer look. He then ran down the road to meet him, flung his arms around the boy, kissed him, and the son wept and said, "Oh, Dad, I'm so stupid, so wasteful. I'm no longer fit to be your son." But the father embraced his boy, wrapped his arms around him, and called and half carried him to the house, and then called for help. "Quick, everybody come. Fetch a warm jacket out of my closet and a pair of good warm shoes and fix him up so he's not so cold. And let's cook the best meal in the house. Chill some fine wine. And let's have a feast to celebrate this day. My boy was lost to us, and now he's come back to life. He was lost, and now he's found." And then, as the good book says, the festivities began. Later that day, they went to a counseling center and negotiated a contract based on chunk blood. Both the father's and the son's expectations carefully spelled out. The son lived up to his end of the agreement, and therefore he was welcome to live in his father's house. Yay, happily ever after. Parental love is strong love. Strong love made that forgiveness possible. And we don't know the rest of the story, not really. But I would imagine it took a lot of really tough love to make a long-term relationship possible. Oh yes, there's another part to that story. The elder brother, Tommy and Bob. And we will take that up when the sermon begins. No reason, no logic, no sense, no justice in his dad's deeds. But deep love makes forgiveness possible, even when it is illogical and unearned. To forgive someone else, think of yourself as a lover of people, not a grudge carrier, but a lover. Forget the logic, and here's the really hard part. Forget fair. Forget justice. Because forgiveness goes beyond those things, beyond justice, to mercy. Forgiveness is the act of a lover who cares more about people's emotional and spiritual well-being than about revenge. Alexander Pope put it this way. To err is human, to forgive, divine. But you and I are not divine, we're just human. We can't always be like a loving parent or parent. Of all the characters in that story, I identify the most with Bobby Lee. Did I say the right one? I understand him. I have felt his anger. I have felt the resentment he had. Like him, I have felt a tight to my sense of being wronged. And I too have found it hard to forgive. And the older one gets, the more those thoughts wake him up in the middle of the night. And you can feel all that old anger all over again if you don't hang on to it. It's the better side of it. I found it hard to forgive, have you? Here is a lighter story, one from England, where some ministers are called vicars. Once upon a time, there was an old woman who, by mistake, was left off the list of invitees to the vicar's garden party. Now, the vicar was reminded by a friend about this mistake, and so he called up the old woman on the morning of the party, and he apologized to her, and he said, "Oh, please forgive me, and I want you to come to the party." And she replied sharply, "It's too late for that. I'm already craving for rain." I understand that woman. There was some kind of perverse pleasure in hanging on to resentment and refusing to forgive and forget. I should have titled this the perverse pleasure. Because there is some kind of perverse pleasure in planning and looking forward to revenge. But it is not pretty. Just ask anyone who's ever lived in the Middle East. The word resentment means to re-feel, to feel again. In resentment, we re-experience an old injury, and we re-hurt ourselves. The Hebrew Talmud says this so well. It tells a story about a person who bears a grudge, and they are like one who, having cut one hand while handling a knife, avenges himself by stabbing the other hand. Without forgiveness, life is governed by an endless cycle of resentment and retaliation. These are the words of Roberto Assagioli, who is an Italian therapist. See, this wisdom is worldwide, but it still takes us a long time to get it into our systems. One of my heroines, Hannah Arendt, she was a survivor of being in a Nazi concentration camp, and she struggled all her life to shake off the anger she felt and to forgive what had been done to her and her family. She finally wrote that forgiveness is the key to freedom and to action. The dictionary tells us to forgive is to give up the wish to punish, the wish to get even with someone. Do not have hard feelings. To pardon, to excuse. Why is this so difficult? I believe we have trouble forgiving others because we do not forgive ourselves. Acts of forgiveness rarely happen alone, They have a two-way dynamic. So if you forgive someone else, they are more able to forgive themselves. If you forgive yourself, you are more able to forgive others. If you are forgiven, you are more able to forgive yourself. And we must forgive ourselves to be healthy. We must love ourselves enough to offer the same understanding and tolerance to ourselves that we would offer to someone else. If we have a prodigal self, we must love our prodigal self enough to say, come to your senses, come home. Let's celebrate and put the past to rest. But how do we learn to love ourselves enough to forgive ourselves? Well, there's a wonderful place available to all of us. The best place I know to learn healthy self-love is through the 12 steps of Alcoholics Anonymous. Alcohol, drug, and food addicts know you're not going to beat your addiction until you are emotionally and spiritually growing. And their program for recovery is, in my opinion, valid for anyone who cares about emotional or spiritual growth. And I feel so strongly about this that the rest of this sermon, I have made copies to hand out at the end of the service to anybody who wants them. Steps 8 and 9 of the AA literature. And the reason I'm familiar with this is because of this wonderful gift. Ministry gives you gifts at times that you'd never expect. This was a parishioner who came to me and said, I'm going to get to work on steps 8, 9, and 10 of the AA materials. And I need a confidant, a counselor, and a partner. Will you be that for me? What a gift. And so because of that person, I came to know this firsthand. Quote, if anyone has wronged me at any time in the past, I must gradually come to forgive them freely and completely. The sooner I do this, the sooner I will be relieved of the grudges and resentments which continually gnaw away at my insides, blocking spiritual growth. I do this by releasing these people from blame, turning them over to my higher power, asking that they be blessed, cared for, and that only good will come to them. And I can greatly help myself do this by doing a kind act for these people, preferably without their knowing I did it and without anyone else knowing. In that step, the seeker will make a list of everyone who has wronged them and against whom they may be carrying angry feelings. Think about it. All the things that have happened to you in your life that caused you great pain, sense of betrayal. It's not fair. Make a list. Get it down in writing so you can see it. And then they use a discipline, one of their choice, prayer, meditation, writing, talking to a trusted confidant, and they use that to express their desire to let go of blame, to release those people and wish them well. And where it's possible, an anonymous kind deed follows. And old anger and old resentments will begin to dissolve. And then comes a harder part, quote, if I have wronged anyone in the past, no matter how justified I think it may have been, I must freely admit this and eventually make amends and restitution wherever I can. The sooner I can do this sincerely and honestly, the sooner I will be relieved of the increasing loads of guilt I have unconsciously carried around for years. And now the seeker makes a second list, the people they have wronged, and acts of restitution follow where possible. Old guilt begins to fade. And now comes the last and most important piece of this exercise, quote, having admitted my wrongs towards others and having made restitution and having freely forgiven all others for their wrongs, done or imagined toward me. I can and want to come to forgive myself for all past wrongs I have done to others and to myself. I want to be gentle but firm with myself, and most of all, patient and understanding." End quote. And self-esteem begins to rise, and personal power begins to grow. We must love ourselves enough to offer the same understanding and tolerance we would offer to someone else when we are at our best. We must love our prodigal selves enough to say, "Come to your senses, come home, let us celebrate, and put the past to rest." Spirit of life, we give thanks for this good life. May we be forgiven if we do not love ourselves or each other for life enough. So may it be. Our closing hymn is number 93, as we rise in body or spirit.